Where the administration has insisted from the beginning there was no help available for the Americans under assault in Libya, none that could arrive in time to change the outcome in Benghazi. Tonight is the first of three exclusive reports charging that claim is just not true. Because the special operator in this piece is fearful of reprisal, we have agreed to conceal his identity. Correspondent Adam Housley has the story.
Many Americans are asking, indeed, I asked myself, how could this happen?
In the 7 months since the Benghazi attacks on 9/11, information from the administration has been incomplete at best. Details and timelines provided by the State Department, the U.S. military, and the CIA have been contradictory and failed to answer many questions. In December, a State Department review concluded,
but there simply was not enough time for U.S. military forces to have made a difference. Having said that, it is not reasonable nor feasible to tether U.S. forces at the ready to respond to protect every high-risk post in the world.
But members of the military who are monitoring events in Benghazi disagree. Only a few dozen people in the world know what happened that night, and Fox News spoke exclusively with a special operator who watched the events unfold and has debriefed those who were part of the response.
I know for a fact that C-110, the UCOM SIF, was doing a training exercise, not in the region of Northern Africa, but in Europe. And they had the ability to react and respond.
The C-110 is a commanders in extremist force, in layman's terms, a 40-man special operations force capable of rapid response and deployment, specifically trained for incidents like the attack in Benghazi. That night, they were training in Croatia, just 3.5 hours away.
We had the ability to load out, get on birds, and fly there at a minimum stage. C-110 had the ability to be there, in my opinion, 4 to 6 hours from their European theater to react.
They would have been there before the second attack.
They would have been there at a minimum to provide a quick reaction force that could facilitate their exfil out of the problem situation. Nobody knew how it was going to develop. And you hear a whole bunch of people and a whole bunch of advisors say, hey, we wouldn't have sent them there because, you know, the security was an unknown situation.
No one knew that.
If it's an unknown situation, at a minimum, you send forces there to facilitate the exfil or medical injuries. We could have sent a C-130 to Benghazi to provide medical evacuation for the injured.
Our source says many connected to Benghazi feel threatened and are afraid to talk. So far, confidential sources have fed some information, but nobody has come forward publicly on camera until now.
The problem is, you know, you got guys in my position, you got guys in special operations community who are still active and still involved, and they would be decapitated if they came forward with information that could affect high-level commanders.
Despite the concern, our confidential source says the community feels there was a betrayal all the way to the top, and that people on the ground in Benghazi were left to fend for themselves.
I don't blame them for not coming forward. You know, it's something that's a risky, especially in our line of profession, to say anything about anything in the realm of politics or that deals with policy.
Our source provides insight into how the U.S. government and military reacted from the moment the attack began through the immediate hours after Ambassador Chris Stevens went missing, what they were told to do and what not to do, as Stevens, Diplomatic Officer Sean Smith, and former Special Operations members Tyrone Woods and Glenn Doherty were killed.
There's a lot of responsibility, a lot of onus that needs to be taken up and accounted for.
The attack began about 9:30 p.m. on September 11, 2012, at a diplomatic compound in Benghazi and culminated roughly 7 hours later at a second location, a CIA annex about 1 mile away. While the official responses from Washington have been that the assets could not have made it to Benghazi in time to stop the second attack that killed Woods and Doherty, our source says otherwise and insists there were at least two elite military units that could have made it in time, including the one training in Croatia.
So besides those guys who went in on their own, we had two more assets that could have been there.
Two more assets that could have been on the ground. It's frustrating. It's upsetting, especially being in the community. The hardest thing to deal with in any kind of, you know, dangerous scenario or gunfight is, you know, we always look to each other to help each other. And that's how we get through situations. It's not about the assets overhead. It's about the guys on the ground.
He also says that as the attack began, there were at least 15 special forces and highly skilled State Department security staff available in the capital, Tripoli, who were not dispatched, even though they were trained as a quick response force. Meantime, a group of American reinforcements also in Tripoli, which included the CIA's global response agent Glenn Doherty and about seven others, took matters into their own hands. A little-known fact which also contradicts the version of events in the State Department report. The team commandeered a small jet and flew to Benghazi to help try and secure the CIA annex still under fire. Doherty would eventually be killed on the roof along with his friend Tyrone Woods, and our source says these men deserve the highest medal of honor for their actions.
If it wasn't for that decision, I think we'd be talking completely different about this entire situation. I think you would be looking at either 20 plus hostages loose, captured by IAQ, or you'd be looking at a lot of dead Americans dead in Benghazi.
We've heard some of these same details from a number of our other sources who have not yet come on camera, also some of our British sources on the ground that night. Brett, tomorrow more of our exclusive interview, including the hunt for those responsible, or the hunt that's lack thereof. Brett?
Interesting story, Adam. Thank you. We'll look for part two tomorrow. What do you make of our first two stories tonight, and what do you think comes next? Let me know on Twitter. You can follow me at Brett there.